On July 28th at the Stone Mountain Archery Center, 64 men, the finest archers in the world, stood 70 meters from their targets. They would shoot 72 arrows to determine rankings for the head-to-head matches that would follow. The highest scorer would face the lowest scorer in the opening round. The second highest scorer would meet the second lowest scorer, and so on. With each round, the field would be cut in half, for a single loss meant elimination. To win the gold medal, the champion would have to survive six straight head-to-head matches. In the women's individual competition, Kim Kyung-wook of Korea defeated He Ying of China, 113-107. It was the fourth successive Olympic gold medal won by a Korean, who have dominated women's archery for more than a decade.
Ladies and gentlemen,
but when the archers got underway for the men's competition, it soon became apparent that there is a changing of the guard. New, young, strong, and nerveless archers from around the world are replacing the champions of the past. By the beginning of the quarterfinal round, with eight archers left, the new innovative one loss and out format has already sent many of the pre-Olympic favorites to the sidelines, including the world's two top-ranking archers, two past world champions, and two Olympic champions. One of the new breed to win his first three matches, 21-year-old Justin Hewish, the last hope for the United States after his two teammates were eliminated in earlier rounds. Hewish is not only competing before a home crowd, but his personality has endeared him to the spectators, a combination of immense talent and boyish enthusiasm that sets him apart from the rest of the world's top archers. Hewish became interested in archery at the age of 14, when his parents, Bernie and Ona Hewish, bought an archery store in Simi Valley, California. He had a natural talent as a youngster, but practicing became a hardship. There were no facilities less than 45 minutes from his home, so Justin Hewish devised his own practice arena.
Well, basically one day I woke up and I was like, I don't want to go 45 minutes to the local archery range and shoot it. So I just started practicing 50 meters from across the street, from my neighbor's lawn, up the driveway, through the garage, out the back door, across the backyard, onto the target mat.
As a matter of fact, we would have gone even farther back into the neighbor's yard if they would open up their doors and let us go into their, you know, kitchen area there to shoot longer distances. And I think, again, it might go back to quote unquote that the lazy side of Justin, if you want to call it that, where rather than drive 35 minutes to Woodley Park, another range where he could get that 50-yard distance, he'd just do it simply here at the house.
In his quarterfinal, Hewish would meet 20-year-old Michele Frangilli of Italy. Frangilli let it be known at the outset that he would be a contender for the gold medal when he finished first in the ranking round, setting an Olympic record.
Frangilli, the only time I ever saw him before the Olympics was at this tournament in Germany. He went there and finished number one on the ranking round and won the tournament. The number one guy going into the elimination rounds usually never wins. And he just went through the first time I ever saw him and just spanked everyone. And I was like, wow. And then we went to the Olympics and he came out and he won the qualification round.
The format is the same for the final three rounds. Each archer will alternately shoot three arrows at a distance of 70 meters.
9 points for Hewish.
The arrows are then pulled from the target. This procedure takes place four times for a total of 12 arrows. Theoretically, a perfect score of 120 points can be reached if the archer shoots all his arrows in the 10-point center ring.
During the actual match with Frangilli, people were saying, well, were you aware that he was ranked number one? And he just shot an Olympic record this, an Olympic record that. And then the tension started mounting even worse.
At the end of nine arrows, Hewish leads Frangilli 85-84. Each has three arrows left. Frangilli shoots first. An eight. Hewish leads by two with two arrows left. Frangilli.
Ten.
Hewish matches him. Hewish still leads by two. Each has one arrow left. A 9 or 10 on his last arrow will give Hewish the victory. An 8. They are now tied. They will go into a sudden death playoff. Hewish will shoot first.
So I just got up there and pretend like it was the first arrow of the tournament and everything's on it. And it just got so quiet and I came the full draw. I mean, you could just hear everything. I mean, a pin could drop and you could hear it a mile away.
Vangeli must shoot a 10 to keep the match going. They are tied again. Vangeli will shoot first in the second tiebreaker. Hewish needs a 10 for the victory.
Well, I was screaming. I'm just like, I made it! My whole family was waving and screaming, and everyone was just crazy.
Now in the semifinal, Hewish is sensational. He crushes Paul Vermeeren of Belgium, winning by 9 points, 112-103.
And target number 3 from the United States of America, Justin Hewish.
Hewish makes it to the final, where he will meet 21-year-old Magnus Pettersson of Sweden, who had 2 magnificent victories over 2 Korean archers in the quarterfinal and semifinal rounds. Both Korean archers were pre-Olympic favorites for championship honors. The stage is now set for the 12-arrow final between 7th-seeded Pettersson and 9th-seeded Hewish. Pettersson's most notable accomplishment took place 1 year earlier when he won the 1995 World Indoor Championship.
Shooting against Magnus, I knew that he could just come on fire anytime because he's the past World Indoor Champion, and I knew that he made it to the gold medal match, and this could be his chance right now to come on fire.
But it is Hewish who has caught fire. After 3 rounds, 9 arrows, he leads Pettersson by 4 points. Incredibly, in gaining this lead, he has shot 3 tens and 6 nines. Each has 3 arrows left. Pettersson's 10 cuts the deficit to 3.
10.
Pettersson can only answer with a 9. Hewish's lead is now back to 4. A 7 or better on his last arrow will close out the match no matter what Pettersson does. In the stands, Bernie Hewish, Justin's father, is videotaping the last act of the drama.
Come on, Justin.
Hewish clinches.
Justin Hewish wins the gold medal. Justin's father is ecstatic. This is how he recorded the last arrow.
when it gets to that final arrow, when Justin finally clinches the match and win the gold medal, all she basically sees is the camera. It goes up to the sky and then down to the ground, and all she sees is it flailing around, and you just hear him screaming, "Yes! Yes!"
Justin Hewish stands on the top step of the award podium as the national anthem is played in his honor. The following day, he will again make it to the top step, this time joining two teammates, Rod White and Butch Johnson, in winning the team championship over the heavily favored Koreans.
I have the unique opportunity to be able to compete individually and team, which is most sports don't have that. You know, it's either a team sport or it's an individual sport. But I was just glad to see that Rod and Butch got a chance to experience victory too. It was nice to have my teammates up there on the podium, standing up there and looking at the flag and the crowd cheering for you and everything. That was really neat.
He's the kid next door. He's the kid you could know from anywhere. You know, we hoped he would do good. He didn't just do good, he did spectacular.
It has been more than 2,000 years since a Greek warrior ran through the plains of Marathon. Since that time, the Marathon has stood as the ultimate test of one's courage. In the 100-year history of the Olympic Marathon, a special few have withstood the challenges of the course and the challenges from within to cross the finish line first. One was Ethiopia's Abebe Bikila. At the 1960 Olympics, Bikila ran barefoot through the streets of Rome to win the gold medal. 4 years later, at the 1964 Tokyo Games, he raced to victory once more and became the first to win two marathon gold medals. Since then, many Africans have followed his path. In Atlanta, Fatuma Roba of Ethiopia outran her opponents to win the Olympic gold medal. She became the first African woman to stand victorious as marathon champion. But her victory was a prelude to the drama yet to take place on the final day in Atlanta. The closest marathon race in Olympic history. It is 7:05 a.m., Sunday, August 4th, the start of the men's marathon. Traditionally, the men's marathon is the last event on the Olympic program, taking place just before the start of the closing ceremonies. But because of the intense heat and humidity of the Atlanta summer, the start of the marathon is moved to the early morning. 124 runners circle the track 3.5 times before leaving the stadium, the beginning of their 26-mile, 385-yard journey. More than any other event, the marathon is the most difficult to predict. With the terrain, the weather, and one's own mental as well as physical preparation determining who will cross the finish line first. Through the first few miles, the lead pack winds its way through downtown Atlanta. Miles 5, 6, and 7. More than 65 men, half the starting field, are in contention for a medal. Through miles 8, 9, and 10, a few try to surge ahead. But they are quickly encircled by the lead group, still more than 50 strong. By 13 miles, the halfway point in the race, more than half the lead pack of 50 still believe they can win the gold medal. For the others, a different goal: to finish. Now, more than 14 miles into the race, several move for the lead. Two of those, Brazilian Luis dos Santos in blue, and Josiah Togwani of South Africa in green, wearing glasses. While Dos Santos is one of the favorites, Togwani is given little chance of winning. His journey to Atlanta is considered miraculous. This is the town of Mzanoni, located 120 miles east of Johannesburg. Mzanoni was one of many segregated areas in South Africa mandated by racial apartheid. Apartheid, the Afrikaner word for separateness, was the policy of segregation set up by the white-led government in 1950. It is among these shacks of cement and corrugated tin that Josiah Togwani lived with his wife and two daughters in the years and months leading up to the Atlanta Olympics, except when he was living at the coal mine 30 miles away. Josiah Togwani earned less than $350 a month as a mine worker, one of the few jobs open to black men in South Africa. His salary helped support an extended family of 10. And it is here that Josiah Togwani trained in the years leading to the Atlanta Olympics.
Living in these conditions and trying to support my wife and kids was hard because I earned very little money at the mine. The only thing that kept me going was being able to run, hoping that I could win races and change my life.
When South Africa was barred from Olympic competition for its racial segregation after the 1960 Games in Rome, all of their athletes suffered.
It was bad for all South African athletes, I think, not to be part of the international community. But it couldn't have been worse for the black athletes, because apartheid itself was bad enough. So I think if you lived under apartheid, nothing could be worse off than apartheid for you.
By 1990, political and social change swept through South Africa. Nelson Mandela, who had spent 27 years in prison for his opposition to apartheid, was released. Formal discussions with the white-led government signaled the end of apartheid. 4 years later, Mandela was elected president. And in 1992, South Africa was welcomed once again into the world athletic community at the Barcelona Olympics. Now at 15 miles here in Atlanta, Josiah Togwani is joined at the front by two other South Africans. Kurt Tais, number 2123, considered the South African with the best chance of winning, and Lawrence Pugh, number 2481. Three South Africans, who just 5 years earlier were unable to compete internationally, are now in the lead.
Well, it was a very proud moment for South Africa because until then, since South Africa was readmitted to international sport, we've always expected a lot of our marathon runners and they've never really produced anything. So to see all three of them running at the front of the field was really something great for South Africans.
Josiah Togwani was not among the fastest South African marathoners leading to Atlanta. So only a victory at the South African Championships in February would allow him to run here. He won, but his joy was short-lived. 1 month later, a carjacker's bullet pierced his chin, leaving a one-inch scar, the only visible reminder today of a harrowing ordeal which nearly cost him his life and causes nightmares to this day.
I picked up some hitchhikers, one who I knew. One of them pulled a gun and told me they were taking my car to hand over my keys. I tried to scare them by turning the steering wheel hard, but that's when I heard the gunshot. I felt no pain, but I saw blood everywhere. I then decided to jump.
Togwani survived his leap from the pickup truck, but suffered a back injury as well as a shattered spirit. With the Olympics less than 5 months away, many questioned whether he would be able to compete.
I was hurt so badly, I lost all hope. I did not think I would be in the Olympics. I did not even think I would recover. Usually when you get hijacked, the carjackers don't leave you alive. I am thankful he was not a good shot.
Past 16 miles, Lee Bong-ju of South Korea, number 1832 in the white shirt, joins the front-running South Africans. It has been said of the Korean marathoners, when they are given the honor of competing for their country, they are expected to win. Lee's presence at the front brings back memories of other great Koreans who have competed with distinction in the marathon. At the 1936 Berlin Olympics, Son Ki-jung, a Korean whose country was occupied by the Japanese, won the gold medal for Japan. And 56 years later, on the same date, Korea's Hwang Young-cho defeated Japan's Koichi Morishita at the 1992 Barcelona Olympics, collapsing just after the finish. Here in Atlanta, the lead pack of 25 closes the gap. Included are most of the pre-race favorites: Antonio Pinto of Portugal, third from the front in green and red, and Spain's Martin Fis on the left, just behind Lee Bong-ju. One relative surprise is Eric Wainaina of Kenya, number 1819 on the extreme right, wearing red. Wainaina, who trains in Japan, is running in only his fifth marathon. At 19 miles, Josiah Tugwani moves ahead. Lee Bong-ju is the only one to respond. Eric Wainaina in third place tries to answer his challenge, but Josiah Tugwani lengthens his lead. Wainaina catches, then passes the Korean. He then closes in on Tugwani. With 5 miles to go, Wainaina overtakes Tugwani. But Tugwani remains just a step behind the Kenyan.
I was not worried about the Kenyan that much. I saw how hard he had to work to remain at the front. Lee Bong-ju was the one I feared. I had lost to him in a marathon a few years ago and saw how strong and determined he is.
Lee Bong-ju regains contact with Tugwani and Wainaina. The lead changes again. Tugwani tries to break away. Only to be caught. They move through downtown Atlanta for the last time. Three men, one Korean, one South African, one Kenyan. All have less than 3 miles to run. All that is left of their 26-mile journey. All that remains before determining who will be Olympic marathon champion. Station just outside Olympic Stadium, with less than 1 mile to run, Josiah Tugwani moves into the lead. Eric Wainaina passes Lee Bong-ju, to be overtaken by Lee in the tunnel. Josiah Tugwani enters Olympic Stadium. There are less than 500 meters to go.
I was so happy when I heard the cheering in the stadium, but I knew they were very close behind me.
Lee Bong-ju and Eric Wainaina are less than 10 seconds behind Tugwani. It is the closest marathon finish in Olympic history.
I looked back to see what was happening. When I saw the gap I had, I knew that Lee Bong-ju could never catch me.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Josiah Tugwane, South Africa, first. Lebong Ju, South Korea, second, 3 seconds behind. Eric Wainaina, Kenya, third, 8 seconds behind Tugwane. 12 hours later at 9 p.m., during the closing ceremony for the Centennial Games of Atlanta, the marathon award presentation begins. Josiah Tugwane receives the gold medal as thousands of spectators and millions of television viewers look on. It is a fitting tribute to the first black South African to stand on the podium as Olympic champion. A fitting tribute to a man and a nation who have overcome so much in sports and in life.
I am happy for what I accomplished here because I succeeded after losing all hope just months before. I won this gold medal for the people of South Africa. I also won this gold medal for President Nelson Mandela. His efforts to end apartheid have made us free. Free to run. Free to be part of the international community. Without him, I would not be standing here today as Olympic champion.
Three days later, Josiah Tugwane returned home to South Africa, to this land blessed with natural wealth. The land where he worked, where he ran, where he raised his children. It was left for one South African to write, "For a nation that has been through such turmoil, one gold medal does not make decades of apartheid melt away, does not put a clamp on racism." But the victory of Josiah Tugwane does give all South Africans a common cause. It does give South Africans of every color hope. We can now have heroes who don't have to be black or white. We can now have heroes who are just South African. And so it was done. The 17 days of the Atlanta Centennial Games were drawing to a close. Representing the 10,000 athletes, flag bearers from 197 nations. But with this ending, there is a new beginning. By tradition, the Olympic flag is passed to the mayor of Sydney, Australia, the host city in the year 2000. Beckoning the youth of the world to meet again in 4 years' time. And for Atlanta and its people, this heart of America's Southland did honor to this celebration that the ancient Greeks called the Truce of Gods. And for millions throughout the world, there are memories that will remain throughout their lifetime. There is much glory to those who made it to the award podium. There is much glory to those who made the attempt. Thank you. But win or lose, they have experienced the joy of the competition, rather than a lifetime not knowing either victory or defeat. And because of them, all of us are the better for it. Many hoped would never come.
Celebrate with us the games of the 27th Olympiad.